What a wonderful job. Well, good morning, loved ones. Don't you love this time of year? I wanted to paint an Advent scene. These are Advent candles. I keep wanting to say calendar. Advent candles, just talking about the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Advent candles, but I was going to give you a little background today. I had painted one of these pictures last year, and I just truly love it and what it represents. And so week one, we are actually in week three right now, but in week one, the scripture is Isaiah 9, 2, and Isaiah 6, verse 7. And the first candle would be lit, representing hope. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. The government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. Don't you love that? He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. Thank God for his righteousness and justice. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. And I'm backing up again. I forgot to say that there's one candle that is lit every Sunday leading up to the birth of Jesus. And so that's why I was saying we're actually in week three. And the three purple candles also represent royalty. And then the pink candle represents joy. And the white candle represents Jesus. So week two is preparation or waiting or prophecy. And the scripture there is Isaiah 40, verses 3 through 5. A voice of one calling in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. Man, hallelujah. Amen. And so this week being week three, which is joy or peace, Matthew 2, verses 10 and 11, when they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with the gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And then week four will be next week, and that is love or adoration. And it's John 3, 16 through 19. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. So I just want to encourage you this morning to celebrate the coming of Jesus, Emmanuel, our God with us. Thank you.
Tammy, great job. I appreciate that. You guys look amazing this morning. So excited to be here in the house of the Lord. So good. Did you guys all have a good week this week? Everybody have a good week?
Yes.
Not everybody. You're having a good week now?
Yes.
He's good. I want you guys to know he's so good. Last week we talked about, you guys remember what we talked about last week about saying we are saved versus not meaning it. There's a lot of people in the world today that say, I've asked Jesus to come in my heart, but they haven't believed. in their heart. They've said with their mouth and haven't believed in their heart that Jesus did what he said he would do, raised from the dead. So we talked about that last week, and we talked about the power that God wants us to have if we would sit in his presence long enough to be endued with power from on high. I gave you opportunity this morning to sit in his presence like that, to be endued with power from on high, to have that kind of power in your heart, in your life, to transform other people's lives by your testimony, by the word and the testimony that you have been through in life. Luke 24, 29 talks about being endued with power from on high. Just waiting, waiting. One more moment. You guys ever get in prayer and you get in the prayer time and you just stop short of really where God wants you to go? You get down there and you pray, and all of a sudden the thought comes to your mind, I got to eat lunch, or I got to eat breakfast, or I got to do this, or I got to do that, and it takes you away from that. I'm asking you to push past that. I feel like that we're in a season right now that we're being checked and tested to see how strong we are as a church. Because the church in the past has failed the mission that God had for it. The mission that God wants for the church has truly failed. Or our country wouldn't be in the shape that it's in today. But because of that failure, God has given us this opportunity to rise up and to shine in the midst of the darkness. To rise up and shine because he lives in us and shines through us. I believe that with my whole heart this morning. Let's just pray. Father, we thank you this morning for what you're doing and what you're going to do today. Father, we thank you for everyone here this morning. God, we glorify your name. For your people, Father, for you helping us to raise and bring up a usable, teachable people. Father, I pray that you would help us as people get saved day in and day out in this city, that God, we would be and we would help them to be discipled. Father, I feel like that's where we've failed as a church as well, is not discipling people into who you've called them to be. Showing them, leading them, guiding them. Father, I feel like we do it like a child being left alone. They'll have to raise themselves if there's not someone there to teach them. I feel like we've helped people come to the cross, but we haven't followed through on our part, Father. So I ask this morning that you would just teach us to be that powerful people, that we would consecrate ourselves in a way that we would be able to dedicate ourselves to one another, to people in this lost and dying world, that they could find freedom like we have. In Jesus' name, amen. Who drove the furthest today?
Sheila.
Park County, I think that's pretty far. Rockville, that's Park County, that's pretty good distance there. My friend Alvin and his family's here this morning. Thank you guys for being here. Thank you, Helen, for driving them here this morning. Bless you for that. So good. We have three Helens in the house, or we have two. Where'd the other one go? She went home. We got two Helens in the house again. So, young one here on the front. Yeah, God is good, man. I tell you what, I was sitting outside yesterday, and that storm come through. And I'm trying to think of what God's doing today on message on power, because we're going to kind of doing a series on power and powerless or whatever. And so I was out there. And I saw this storm clear. It was over here. I saw this storm, and the storm was coming in. I seen the lightning, and, the wind started blowing a little bit. And then over on this side, I saw the sun, the white clouds, and there was this, a break in the clouds. I could see the blue sky. Just reminded me of this song, "Behind Every Dark Cloud Smiles shines the Smiling Face of Jesus." We would sing it, but I'm not going to. But I saw that. And I thought, God, man, that's where I want to be, right there in that blue spot where the sun is shining. Because there's power in that. That brings life. Like Jesus brings life. But this storm over here can bring death and destruction like sin. And I believe the Lord has shown me just that. The difference between those two. We have the raging storms that come in, and then we have this raging sin that we live with. Day in and day out. Things we battle day in and day out to try to get rid of, today I'm going to help you to get rid of those things that you fight and you battle. I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that today, because it's so important that we get to that point to where we lose track of us in the life that we're living and get on track with where he has us going and what he wants for us to do. If you have your Bibles this morning, Ephesians 2:8 says this. For by grace you have been saved through faith, that not of yourselves is the gift of God. We're saved by grace. Grace is an unmerited divine gift for all of us from Father God, so that we can live a righteous life. In Romans 6, verse 1, we're going to be in Romans for just a little bit. Verse 1 says this. I don't know, our guy left back here, so you don't have it. Go into the Bible section and type in Romans 6, 1, the very top. Push the Bible. Shelley, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me, Philippians 4, 13. I think that's right. I'll just read them. If you guys have your Bibles, you can turn. We just want to help you out up here. If you have your phone, tablet, whatever, or if it's in your head. What shall we say then? Are we to continue in sin that grace may increase? Are we to continue in sin so this grace that we received would increase? May it never be. How shall we who are dead to sin live in it? Think of that. If you're dead to sin, how can you live in it? How can your life be riddled with sin if you're dead to it? Verse 3 says this. Or do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus have been baptized into his death? So when he died and we've been baptized into Christ Jesus, we died with him. When we come back up with him. Therefore, we have been buried with him. This is verse 4. Therefore, we have been buried with him through the baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, so we might walk in the newness of life. One version says, so we could be empowered to walk in a freshness of life. That's where I want to be. I want to be empowered to walk in that newness, that freshness of life that God has for me. Guys, listen, I dig in and day out. Man, I dig in and day out. And I'm not kidding you. I don't have it all perfect and I don't have it all right. But I do know that I dig in. I'm asking God every day. Things I see in my life, where can I fix this? How can I fix this? How can I make this right? God, I'm having financial struggles here. What can I do? He says, don't put everything on a charge card. Pay for it if you have. You get too much stuff. You're getting too much stuff if you have to build a garage to put it all in. I'm not there, but I'm just saying. I'd like to have a garage, but I'm not there yet. Verse 5 says this, for if we have become united with him in the likeness of his death, certainly we shall also be in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin. For he who has died is free from sin. So remember last week we talked about people say, yeah, I'm a Christian. I've asked Jesus to come to my heart, you know, and yeah, you know, but a lot of them are doing it to get something from God or get something from people or this or that, whatever. They really didn't mean it with their heart. So that's what we was challenging last week, you know, are you really saved? Are you really a Christian? D- did you really ask Jesus to come in your heart for the right reasons? Did you ask him for that? And so today, and a lot of you realized last week maybe that you didn't, and you're realizing that, and God's showing you all those things. I believe once that we die to sin, we cannot live in sin. If you guys want to challenge my belief, I believe that once we die to sin, we cannot live a sinful lifestyle and be dead to sin. Now, I'm not saying that you can't trip and fall in sin, because I'm not saying that. I'm saying that you can trip and you can get in a bad place and get around some bad people and trip for a moment. And Jesus said he's an advocate for that sin. He's faithful and just to forgive us of that sin and cleanse us from that sin into righteousness. Doesn't mean that we can stay there. When it says that grace may abound, should you just stay in it so grace gets greater? You can't do that. You can't do that. If we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. Knowing that Christ, having been raised from the dead, is never to die again. Death is no longer a master over him. For that death that he died to sin once and for all. But the life that he lives to God. You guys understand, when something happens once and for all, it's over. I tried to compare this to something. You know, when you, how many of you know how to ride a bicycle? If you're old enough to ride a bicycle. Do you not know how to ride a bicycle yet? No. Okay, you're right here. Yeah, you keep turning. No, right in front of you. She. How many of you know how to ride a bicycle? Yeah, okay. I was just checking. Will you ever unlearn that? You're never going to unlearn that. You're always going to know how to ride a bicycle till you're dead. So, if you're dead to sin, then you're dead to sin. You should never be able to go back to that sin lifestyle, to walk in that sinful lifestyle if you're dead to sin. And this is how I see it. And I can be challenged, and if you guys want to challenge me on any of this, I will get my team together of a powerful team. No, we're not going to debate it. We're just going to say it. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Don't just take my word up here verbatim. Get in the Bible yourself and dig into it and find out what I'm saying and what I'm not saying. How many of you go to the store? How many of you go to the store and... buy food and don't cook it? I mean, how many of you go to the store? Bad illustration, Jason. Bad illustration. Because I think my wife has done that too. She's saying, don't. She's saying, no, don't tell me. Have you ever come home and set food on the put food away and you set it over by the freezer, but you went and did something else, and the next day you come out and the food's still sitting down outside of the freezer? Anybody else ever did that? Is that a common thing that we do? Wait a minute, let me get some different illustrations here that might. I'll use this one here. How many have said a big yes to God? Big yes to God. Oh, man. If you did, you're going to have a long life of yeses to God. If you said yes, then you're going to have a long list and line of yeses to God. What I'm trying to get at is that there's always another part to something. We can't start with this and then just stay there. You know, how many have bought, I'm back to the groceries, how many have bought groceries and left them in your car and drove, well, okay. You guys need to straighten up. How many of you are on Facebook too much that you're on your phone while you're out there loading groceries and you leave groceries in the car? So that's a problem. We've eliminated the problem right there with that. Let's go on. Verse 11. Wow. That did not go how I planned it in my head. Even so, consider, and this is verse 11, even so, consider yourselves to be dead to sin, but alive to God in Jesus Christ. Verse 12, therefore do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lust. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness. But present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God. Now, this can go a long way. This can get deep. But with our feet, we can take our places we shouldn't go. With our hands, we can do things we shouldn't do. With our minds, we can think things we shouldn't think. With our eyes, we can look at things that we shouldn't look at. One is going to lead us to death, and one is going to lead us to life. What he's saying is, if you're dead, do not let the members, your body, take you into sin anymore. But let it lead you to life through righteous living, through Jesus who is righteous. Because there's some of us that say, I'm a Christian, and I live this way, and I really believe that you have not been sanctified holy. And that's okay, because it's not something you can't obtain. If you're still alive, you can still obtain anything that we're talking about. But we need to be to that point that we do not use these instruments that God give us to live in sin. To use the things that God give us to minister in this world and use them to live in sin with. We just can't do it. We're not supposed to do it. It's not righteous living. For sin shall not be a master over you. This is verse 14. For you are not under law, but under grace. He's repeating himself again. And this is it. When you see something in the Word of God that repeats itself, you need to pay attention. What then shall we sin because we are no longer under law but under grace? May it never be. One verse says, God forbid. Do you not know that when you present yourself to someone as slaves to obedience, you are slaves of the one whom you obey? Either sin resulting in death or a slave to obedience resulting in righteousness. And this is the Word of God. This is Romans 1. You guys can read it. Romans 1, chapter 6. The whole thing talks about this. If you guys don't realize by now, we're in a season that we are being tested. In our country, in everything that's going on, we're being tested to be whether. How many of you have been fearful? I'm just be honest. How many of you have been fearful about the election? Yeah. How many of you are just not raising your hands? Just kidding. I was there for a moment. Now, the difference is, I want to tell you the difference. You live in it. Because I feared, I doubted, and that was sin. I'll just be honest with you. But what I'm not doing is living a lifestyle of sin. I said, God, why am I fearful of this thing? You have everything in control. You know exactly what's going on. I am in you and you are in me. So therefore, I don't have to worry about these things. I don't have to worry about the outcome of an election. All I have to do is make sure my heart and your heart are in alignment. That I am living my life for you, with you. Everything else will fall into play. What are they going to do? Kill me? The Bible says don't fear those who can kill you. So I'm not going to fear that. The worst that could happen is they could send me to heaven. That's the worst. That's probably the best thing that could happen. But for my wife, it would be maybe the worst thing. Maybe, I don't know. The worst thing that could happen is they send me to heaven. You want me to repeat that? It's very important when I repeat something. She's focusing on that back here. Verse 17, it says, but thanks to God that through you, though you were slaves to sin, you became obedient from the heart to the form of teaching in which you were committed. And having been freed from sin, you became a slave to righteousness. I want to emphasize this part. It says obedient from the heart. That's where we need to be obedient from. I remember when I lived in religion, when I was in a religious sector church, I remember when I was there and I did things because they did things. When they said you couldn't wear jewelry or things of costly array, I cut all my jewelry off. I took my necklace off. I got rid of all of it. I had to cut rings off because they wouldn't come off because my hands were so fat. But I had to cut rings off. And this is what it was. I was doing what they said to do. Not what God was saying to do, but I was following along. And then I followed along, and I said, this, and this. And then we got to the point I started saying, well, wait a minute. Something's not lining up here. Something's not right. You know, I'm just like following along with everybody and what they're saying to do and not actually doing what God is wanting me to do. So I started hearing the voice of God just little bits here and there. I started like saying, wait a minute. You guys can do this, but you preach this. Or you guys can do this, and you talk this. And what I realized from this denomination that I was in back then, bless them. God loves them. They're an amazing people. But what I realized is they look good on the outside. But their hearts were a mess. I mean, they presented themselves well on the outside. And we try to do that. We try to form like that. We present ourselves good on the outside. We look good on the outside. But our inward man is just a wreck and a mess. We try to put on that facade that we're good and we're great by what we wear. And there's no truth in that. There's really no truth in that. You can wear the nicest, have the most money, wear the nicest things, all those things. You can do those things and still be riddled with sin. It doesn't matter. And God wants to free us from that. He said, I'm speaking to you in human terms because of the weakness of your flesh. For just as you presented yourselves, members, as slaves to impurity and to lawlessness, resulting in further lawlessness, so now present yourselves, your members, as slaves to righteousness, resulting in sanctification. And I want to stop there a minute because if you don't know what sanctification is, what I believe that God's saying here is to be sanctified holy is to take the want to sin out of your life. It takes the heart of sin, what sin is to you, it takes that out. I mean, how many of you have gotten saved and still wanted to sin? You still lean to those things. Sanctification takes the desire to sin out of your heart. Where you get saved, and then when you sin, you recognize it right away, and you don't want to do it. You don't do it purposely or intentionally. You know, the Bible says the definition of sin is to him to know to do good and do it not. To him it is sin. So if you know to do something good and you don't do it, it's sin. And I know there's a fine line to that. And it says, if you willfully transgress against God's law, then it's sin. If you willfully, God says, do not do this, and you do it, it's sin to you. I don't care if your brother's doing it. I don't care if your neighbor's doing it. They might be able to do it. You know, if Bob Peden, he's not here today, but if God said, Bob Peden, you can't play golf no more. If Bob goes out and plays golf, he's sinning. It's true. Don't think God's going to do that. He's teaching me. Bob is teaching me how to play golf. So maybe I'll tell him. I remember when I was in the holiness movement. I remember I had these football cards. I loved collecting football cards. And man, I tell you what, I would every paycheck I would go to the store back when I don't even know if they have those kind of stores anymore. But you would buy those little packs of cards. Man, it would be like addiction. Man, I'd like, ooh, I'd pick which pack I wanted. I'd grab that pack out. I was like, oh man, this is gonna be awesome. And I'd open it up, tear it open slowly because you don't want to hurt any of the cards. And I would open it up. And I had this Brett Favre redemption card. And I could have got an autographed, a whole series of cards from the whole NFL, an autographed series of cards just from that one card. That's how valuable that one card was. So when I started going to the Holiness Movement, they said, yeah, that's sinful. You can't have that. And I listened to them because I really wanted everything that God had for me. I just didn't know I had to wear long sleeves and wear my hair up and... I mean, I didn't know I had to do that. I don't think you have to do. You can do that. If you choose to do that, it's fine. There's nothing wrong with it. But they made it like it was a law that I had to do some of these things. And they said, you have to get rid of those cars. And I said, well, what do I do? And so one of the evangelists came up. He said, well, the Satan's going to use your money either way. So he goes, you might as well sell it and make a few dollars off of it. Because Satan's going to use your money. That's the kind of advice I got back in. So, it wasn't good. It wasn't all good. And I love you guys if you're watching this. And so so anyhow, I had all these cards, and I had about $4,000 worth of cards. And I sold them for like $400. And that Brett Favre redemption card expired, and it was worth way more. But so I feel like that God wants us to be so sanctified, so set apart for Him, that none of this stuff affects us in the world. None of the stuff that's going on in the world is going to affect us. So set apart for Him, living for Him. Guys, it's not about just waking up and going to work. I mean, yeah, we got to work. I mean, that's part of life, you know. That's part of the curse of Adam and Eve when they fell. You know, they both were there. And so... we have to live life. But the Bible says that we're not in this world. Or we're not of this world, but we're in this world. So we're just going and we just live. We pay our bills. But our most important thing that we should do is make sure our lives, our heart is ripe and ready for God. Or ripe and ready for the next person that steps in front of us that we can minister to. I've missed it so many times when someone stepped in front of me and I could have ministered to him. And I walk away and I'm like, missed that one to the point I wanted to go chase them down. Yeah. Hey, I was supposed to say this, but it's in the wrong moment then that you can't do it. So I've been everywhere and I've missed it. But I've learned, I've got a technique and I learned how to relate to people certain ways, and that's really helped me to be able to start a conversation with people. And I know some of you guys are fearful of that. How many are fearful of just talking to someone, just like stepping up and just telling them about Jesus Christ? Yeah, you guys are not, none of you. I expect to see this place doubled by next week. I have a goal. My goal is to minister to at least 3 people a day. I don't always get the goal, but most of the time I do. You know, I'm like one of those state troopers. He's got to have so many tickets by the end of the month, and you're driving by, and you just happen to be going 1 mile over the speed limit. Beep, beep. Got my ticket, got my quota, get to keep my car. The ones that drive the Mustangs, that's what it is. They have to keep such a quota. If they don't, they don't get to drive the Mustang no more, or the Camaros, or all those cars. So they're pulling you over for license plate light being out. It's because they want to keep your car. That's why. So be nice to them, because they're nice cars. I mean, they're fast. driven them. Love it. So just being honest, we don't have to raise hands. I'm going to ask this question, just answer it in your heart. If you know you're saved, but if you truly set yourself apart for God, for a purpose, consecrated yourself and sanctified yourself holy for God, have you truly did that? Guys, it's serious. It's serious stuff. I mean, this is a whole new step that we're stepping into. If you haven't, if you're still living in sin, you're trying to like, you're fighting that one thing or that two things or that lifestyle, I believe that through this sanctification that you're not going to desire that no more. And therefore, all you're going to have to do is break the habit of it. Or in times, God, like for me, God took everything away right away immediately. But you guys know that we've talked about this before. When you cut some roses down and you put roses in a vase, they're going to be roses for a little while and they're going to be alive and you're going to see the life of them. You put an aspirin in there every now and then and it'll make them live a little bit longer. But they eventually die. And that's how some sin is. You cut it at the root, eventually the fruit of it's not going to be visible no more. It's going to be death. And therefore, you're living a sanctified, holy life. And that's what you need to do. Cut every sin at the root. Sanctify yourself holy. If you still see the fruit there, if you still see something going on, the fruit there, all you got to do is just continue, just go back and say, God, did I cut this off? Did I get to the root of this one because it's still growing? And I believe in that. You're going to have such freedom that you're not going to struggle in any area in your life. Yes, there will be trials and tribulations and things are going to come your way, but you're not going to battle and struggle because you're going to know God's going to answer everything according to his will and the way he designed things to be. So if you guys will stand, if you turn the ambient music up just a little bit. I don't care if you come to the altar every week until we get this right. I really don't. Every week, every service, doesn't matter. It's not about that. It's about you getting yourself where you need to be. I promise you in this place, I've said it before and I'll say it again. If you come to the altar, nobody's going to look and go, why are they there? What did they do? They're not going to say, what did you do, Job? Like his wife did. What did you do, Job? No, they're not going to say that. They're going to say, praise the Lord. They want deeper revelation, deeper walk, more intimacy. Intimacy. Into me you see God. Into me you see. I want more intimacy with you. And that's what we need. Helen, come here a minute. Before we. Helen has something she wanted to share. She came here today to share this specifically.
I just wanted to say that I've been struggling a lot recently. I just kind of feel like I'm going back into that hole that I was in before I came here. But the songs they were singing this morning, it kind of changed what I was originally going to say. Because when they were singing, the verse came in my head. I think it's Psalm 46:10. And it says, be still and know that I am God. And it just kind of hit me different because I was like thinking, all these things are going on, all this stuff is happening, the world sucks. But that's something that never changes, is the way that God loves me and the way that he holds on to me. And I was just thinking about that this morning. And I just kind of felt like he had his arms wrapped around me this morning and I felt a sense of peace. And it was really what I needed because I've been just really struggling, and I needed to be held, and that's what I got this morning. So that's all I have to say.
Actually, Helen, the world don't suck. Really don't. We can make it what we want to make it.
Amen.
God is good all the time, and he's here with us. So the world's really good. We just see all the bad in it. But if we sanctify ourselves holy, we can take that and we can change that. We can take the bad and make it good. We can reach into the bad part of someone's life and make it good. Not what we say, but what we carry. So I'm asking you this morning to carry sanctification in your heart. I'm asking you this morning to come and pray. The altars are open. Just come and kneel down. If your family, if you got someone you want to bring up with you, come and pray. And just watch what God's going to do. Watch what he's going to do. Come and pray. Father, we do thank you this morning. You know, every heart here this morning. Father, you know the battles that we have. Let us be honest with ourselves this morning. That we would live a pure life, a holy life. Consecrated unto you. Jordan, what's the Lord saying to you this morning? Come pray. And come pray. Don't wait. It's what we do. We wait. Wait for the enemy to talk us out of it. Just don't do that. Just don't wait for him to talk us out of it. The first thought that comes to your mind says, I'm not where I need to be. Then you're not where you need to be. You need to be at the altar. I go off first thoughts a lot of time. It helps me. My first instinct, when the Lord has a word for me, it's the first thing that comes to my mind. I'm not going to call you guys all out, so don't be scared. I'm not going to call you out. That was specific. The Lord showed me that. But yeah. But you guys know your own lives. You know your heart. You know what you struggle with. You know the sin that you struggle with. If you're struggling with sin, then you're not sanctified holy. Just come and get sanctified. Clear it up. Get it out of there. Move it out. I said last week, man, I don't want to stink. I don't want to sit in it. I don't. Don't want any part of it. Don't want any part of it at all. Our prayer team that wants to come up and pray with these ones here at the altar. Our prayer teams can come up and pray. Ricky and April, I'd like for you both to come up here because I would love to have a group praying for you guys. I just feel like a heaviness and a weight. So my prayer team, three or four of you, it's right here is fine. I want you guys to come and pray for Ricky and April. You know, they got one kid, one on the way, young marriage. It's what God to bless them. Take off a load that they carry. Shelly, why don't you come up and pray? Let's see about there. That's good. Jordan, stay there till you're done. Anybody else want to pray? So Rick and April, if you guys could do me one, hold on 1 second, Shelly. If you guys, I want you guys to do something. We're gonna do a prophetic act here. I want you guys to face each other. I want you to hold hands. I want you to look in each other's eyes. That first love, that first moment. That's what he wants. What he sees. Father, we thank you for Ricky. And thank you for your love for him, God, for his heart. The father, a fatherless father. Learning as he goes. Bless him, Lord. Be with him. Strengthen him. Glorify your name through him. Her heart, she's a strong woman, has some strong values, some strong opinions. Father, thank you for her. You know, they couldn't have kids. We couldn't have kids. We got to meet them and pray over them. They tried for a while, couldn't have kids, and had that first baby. Now they're having another one. God changed things. He answered that prayer. And that prayer was that you guys would have the strong, solid family. I know it's tough, guys. One on the way. The fields you guys work in, the jobs that you have, the separation. I know it's tough, but hang in there. It's going to get better. It's going to get great. The reason I called you up here this morning, I felt like the Lord showed me that you guys were just carrying this heavy weight on your shoulders. Maybe you've been, I don't know, divided a little bit. He's here to unite you right now. That's what this is about. What this is about this morning. Ricky, you remember when you fell in love? First time you said, I love you. April, you remember? I want you to pull out of each other what you saw with each other then. Life throws some curves. I understand that. But don't let it get you. You have a family around you that's going to support you. Hope you're not mad that I called you out. I just felt like that's what the Lord said. You guys have a family. Well, you didn't before, you do. So, Father, we just consecrate this marriage right now. We sanctify this marriage to you. You're the one that formed this marriage. We thank you right now that you are working right now, even now in their minds. Some patterns of thinking that's been wrong. Some words that have been said that's been wrong. It's been damaging. False accusations. We just break all that off right now in Jesus' name. Break off any fatherlessness issues right now in Jesus' name. Trauma. Break it off right now in Jesus' name. Good stuff. Just stay there, man. You're all right. Good all day. Anybody else want to pray? Forget about the 27th. Sign up sheet back there for the Christmas party. It's at 1 o'clock. Sign up if you're gonna come. We're gonna have a little lunch. You guys are amazing. Have an amazing week. Lord bless you.